Do you guys see the face that's on my shirt? Yeah, this face. That was the face that I made as I was watching these movies. We are coming to the end of 2020, and I have two words to say about that. Thank God. I think that I can speak for a lot of people out there when I say that 2020 was not a good year. In fact, it was actually a shitty year. I mean, this was a shitty year. All because, as you can probably guess it, the virus, to which the virus has either delayed or has canceled many things out there and has been pushing movies I was looking forward to a lot into next year. But shockingly enough, guys, there were more than 10 movies that I saw this year. And in fact, I did see 10 crappy movies this year, shockingly enough. 2020, it was a terrible year. These movies, however, were just the icing on that shitty cake that happened this year. So yes, if you guys could not tell by the title of this video, I am here with you guys to share my top 10 worst films of 2020. Now, before I go on, I must issue a couple of guidelines, as I always do before I do these top 10s. The first of which being that I did not see every movie that came out this year. Now, even though there weren't a lot of movies that came out this year, there were more than enough, and unfortunately, as I say this every year, I did not see every movie that came out this year. And if you guys want me to wait until I saw every movie, we'd be waiting a couple of more years, even though not a lot came out this year. The second of which being is that this is my subjective list. I completely understand that my top 10 worst is not going to be the same as every other top 10 out there. If you guys like some of these movies on this list, I'm happy for you, but for me personally, I do not like these movies, in particular my number one that I absolutely despise. Third and final is that let's just have a great time roasting, but not in a loving way, but the type of roasting to which we absolutely murder these things by ripping and tearing them apart in many more ways than one. Also, by the way, before I continue, I feel like I should mention this as well. These are not going to be reviews of the movies that are on my top 10, rather short condensed versions as to why I put them on my list. But if you guys do want to see the actual reviews of these movies, just type in the movie on YouTube and also my name, and you should be able to find my review of it. Now, before I go on, surprisingly enough, I do have some dishonorable mentions. I do have a couple of films that, while they did not make my top 10, I still don't like them nonetheless. And in terms of my dishonorable mentions, I'm gonna read them off my phone because I'm a professional like that. But anyways, my dishonorable mentions are Underwater, The New Mutants, and Scoob. Congratulations, you guys. While you may not have made my top 10 worst, I still don't like you. Alrighty, guys. With that being said, let's rip off this big-ass band-aid that was 2020 and get into my top 10 worst films of 2020. Let's get it on. Number 10. Kicking off my top 10 list at my number 10 is Bloodshot, the most laughably bad comic book movie I have seen in a long time. Do you guys even remember Bloodshot? Because if not, I'm happy for you, because I remember almost every little thing about this movie. Vin Diesel seems like a really cool dude from what I've seen in interviews. He actually sounds like a really down-to-earth, genuine guy, and I applaud him for trying to do something else outside the Fast and Furious franchise, but my god, Bloodshot is just so damn bad, and it's stupid, and there are so many scenes that have me laughing my ass off with how bad it was. This is essentially what Bloodshot is comprised of: an action scene, over exposition to the point where they're just explaining things to you like an idiot, then an action scene, over exposition where they might as well explain the entire movie to you, and rinse and repeat. Honestly, during this movie, I just remember being like, are you kidding me? The visual effects didn't help out at all, even though I will say that there is that one shot where you see Vin Diesel's chin, or not his chin, but his cheek being blown off. That looked cool, but everything else looked like a 90s action movie that should have come out in the 90s. Number 9. When it comes to Disney's live action remakes, I have actually quite enjoyed them for the most part, with only a select few that I dislike. Well, now we can add Mulan to the list that I dislike. And this is a damn shame, because I was actually looking forward to this movie a lot given how much I love the original animation. If you guys have seen the original animation, you will all know that Mulan is a terrific central character, has great side characters, it's full of adventure, full of a lot of fun, with amazing battle sequences, a great emotional story, with not only an amazing villain, but a great message. However, when it comes to the live action remake, it doesn't have any of these things. Now, to be fair, I will say this, Donnie Yen is by far the best aspect about this movie, even though he has little to no screen time. And when it comes to cinematography, this is a beautiful looking movie when it's not shot against a green screen. Yuffie Lee may look like Mulan, but she is definitely not Mulan. That's for a damn certain. And it's even worse when one of the so-called villains, to which, by the way, who has more character development than Mulan herself, but she is essentially used as a catalyst to essentially just hammer down the film's heavy-handed message. The fact that they put this film on Disney Plus at first for $30, are you kidding me? This was a movie that just made me livid as I was watching it. And that goes to Antebellum. Oh my god, this movie. Now, what I can say about Antebellum is this. Antebellum has a really cool concept. And if that concept were executed right, this could have been a really cool and a really scary Twilight Zone-like movie. However, that concept couldn't have been executed any more atrociously. This movie actually has a really cool opening one-shot take sequence. Even during that first 15 minutes, I was still kind of on board, even though I was starting to get angry with this movie. But after a certain thing gets revealed to which I called a million miles away, this movie just starts to take a big nosedive. But still, even during that nosedive, I was thinking to myself, there is no way that this movie can get even worse. And sure enough, it does. I can see what the filmmakers are attempting to say and what they're trying to do with the horrors of slavery, but everything just came off for the sake of shock value. By the end of this movie, I'm telling you guys right now, there were so many of these moments. What? And as if things couldn't get worse by the film's ending, I just wanted to get rid of it altogether.
Number 7.
After a certain January horror film, The Witch, don't worry, we'll talk about later on, it seemed that January was actually starting to become pretty decent. But then the turning came around and January showed its ugly face once more. Now, what I'll say about this movie is this. The concept for The Turning is there. This is a really cool concept. But they were just like, okay, here's the concept, but we're not gonna do anything with it. This movie does have a really cool look to it, and there is one, and I mean just one, creepy moment. Everything else about The Turning is just full of either dumb scares or just cheap ass jump scares. Oh my god, the jump scares. Seriously, what the hell is it with January and jump scares? Finn Wolfhard looks like he's having a fun time playing this character, but it's still a generic douchebag character. And Mackenzie Davis's character has every opportunity to end this haunting, but due to a damn pinky promise, oh no, god forbid she breaks a pinky promise. And then there's the ending, or I should say a lack there of an ending. It seemed like it was starting to go somewhere, and then it cuts and I just thought, wait, what? Don't watch The Turning, just watch The Haunting of Bly Manor. So much better.
Number 6.
This is a movie that I am pretty certain will be even higher on other people's lists, and in fact, it might even be their number 1. But for me, my number 6 is Doolittle. Now, Doolittle for me is a very interesting movie to say the least, because let me explain. Doolittle is not a good movie. In fact, it is a terrible movie. But at the same time, I didn't hate myself watch this movie. Doolittle was like watching a train wreck. But at the same time, it was like watching a fascinating train wreck. I know it's weird to say like that, but I don't know how much more I can explain than that. Every choice that this movie made, it was like watching this train wreck get even worse and worse by the end. This movie has a great cast with Robert Downey Jr. doing this really weird accent. I don't know what the hell he was doing. And when it came to the voice cast, you have Marion Cotillard, Tom Holland, Kamal Nanjiani, John Cena, Craig Robinson, Emma Thompson. I mean, what did the cast see in this movie to sign on with the script? Antonio Banderas is in this movie, just feels like for no reason whatsoever. Now, don't get me wrong, guys, even though Doolittle to me was a fascinating train wreck to watch unfold, it is still an absolute failure in every single aspect. If you have kids, don't show them this movie, please.
Number 5.
Alrighty, guys, it is time to get into my top 5 worst films of 2020. Now we are really getting into the shit, so here we go. Coming in at my number 5 spot is Monster Hunter. Now, before I get to you, I should say this. Paul W.S. Anderson has made 2 films that I actually quite like. The first Mortal Kombat film is, in fact, still my favorite video game adaptation. Resident Evil I find to be pretty decent, but everything after that I have either really disliked or I have absolutely hated. How Paul W.S. Anderson still gets the rights to make these films and how developers keep giving him the rights? Seriously, Capcom, What the fuck do you see in this guy? He absolutely butt-fucked Resident Evil, and he butt-fucked Monster Hunter even more so. The Monster Hunter world is full of such rich mythology for such a cool story. But what does Paul W.S. Anderson do instead? He decides, rather instead of concentrating on the cool Monster Hunter character, he decides to focus on this generic soldier character who he could give two shits about. There's barely a story. In fact, was there a story in this movie at all? They don't even fucking hunt monsters in this movie at all. And then when you see the Rathalos, oh my god. The Rathalos looked so bad, holy shit. Paul W.S. Anderson, stay away from video game adaptations, please.
Number four.
Oh god, this fucking movie. This was a sequel that everybody wanted, right? I mean, seriously, who didn't want Brahms the Boy 2? I hope you guys can still spot sarcasm. When it came to the original film that came out back in 2016, that film was surprisingly decent. Now, it wasn't particularly good, but for a January horror film, it was actually surprisingly pretty well made. But then when I heard that there was a sequel, I just thought, why? There is no fucking point. Brahms the Boy 2 is predictable. You could see everything coming from a mile away. And it's not even a scary movie. There's no effort given to the scares at all. And then there's the ending. Oh my god. If you guys have seen the original film, the plot twist of the original film is that originally they had thought that Brahms was a doll that moved by itself from room to room. But the plot was that there was actually a man living with inside the house, moving the doll from place to place, which I thought was actually pretty damn cool. This is the thing that completely fucks over everything. They still acknowledge that there was still a boy, or a man I should say, living within the house, but they say that the doll was actually possessed. Are you fucking kidding me? The original film was fine, but it didn't warrant enough to make a sequel. It sets up for a third movie. Please. For the love of all that is mighty, do not make a third film. Oh my god, now we're getting into my zeros of the year. Fuck. Getting into my number three spot is Fantasy Island. First of all, before I continue, I just want to say, I've met Michael Pena. He's a really cool guy. He's very genuine and down to earth. He's very entertaining. I found him to be a really funny person. Michael, you're an awesome guy. But seriously, what in the shitting hell did he see in the script? This movie is just a total train wreck, and I absolutely just... I thought this movie was never gonna end, seriously. The script of this movie is so bad that you can tell everything that's gonna happen. And by the way, this doesn't even feel like a first draft. It feels like a spec script that they wrote in 3 days. They sold it to the studio, and they're just like, let's film this thing! This movie tries to be a comedy, it tries to be a sci-fi, and it tries to be a horror film, and it fails at every single one of them. I didn't laugh, I didn't think any part was cool, and I didn't find this movie to be scary at all, because this movie is filled with a bunch of cheap jump scares. Fantasy Island has no creativity, it is just dull to the T. I have not seen the original TV show, nor the reboot that came out in the 90s, but seriously, the shows couldn't have been this goddamn bad.
Number two.
January horror films, why do you do this to me? 2020 has been a pretty shitty year, and thank god it's almost over. This movie should have been a pretty clear indication for how this year was gonna go. And I'm of course talking about The Grudge. Not only did this movie start off this year shitty, but it started off this decade with such a big old shit stain. I have not seen the original film. I think it's called Ju-on, although I've heard good things. I have seen the first remake, to which I think the original director made. I wasn't a fan of that movie. This remake, however, makes that first remake look surprisingly decent. And that is a feat right there. John Cho and Lindsay Shay and Andrea Riseborough, they are great actors. I have seen them in great stuff. How in the hell did they get suckered into this movie? They're terrific actors. They deserve better than this. This movie is boring as hell. I'm telling you guys right now, I was so bored during this movie that I was falling asleep. In order to keep myself awake, I kept moving around and fidgeting around in my seat just to keep myself awake. And not to mention, it is not even remotely scary. Because it goes for the cheap jump scare. You see a child that's composed. Oh, we'll do a shot where our kid are staring on the very right side of the screen. We'll have a random jump scare. Oh, you have a camera that's gonna pan, whip pan right. Jump scare right there. Oh, there's gonna be a character that's leaning over a surface. Well, something just come out of nowhere and grab them by the throat for a cheap jump scare. You can see every fucking jump scare that's gonna come out. The Grudge feels like a horror film made for the Lifetime channel. It is that fucking bad. The moment that this movie ended, I shot up out of my seat and I speed walked out of that movie theater.
It's number one.
We are finally at my number one worst movie of 2020. This movie left me heartbroken. I was frustrated. I was disappointed. I was livid. But most of all, this movie broke me by the end of it. You guys should probably know what it is. But my number one worst movie of 2020 is Artemis Fowl. I was looking forward to this movie so much. I loved these books so much as a kid. And when I heard that they were finally adapting these books, save the anger, save it. Then I saw that movie. They fucked it up! I don't know where to fucking start with this movie. This movie is a fucking train wreck. Especially as a fan of the book, I felt like I was being slapped in the face a bunch of times. I felt like I was punched in the gut and kicked in the balls repeatedly watching this movie. Kenneth Branagh, I love you as a filmmaker, but what the fuck happened? I understand that you cannot keep everything from the book, but at least keep the spirit in the characters. There was not a single thing that was right from the books into the movie. Artemis Fowl is not a cold, compelling villain that has a great character arc. Instead, he is this really wannabe robotic person that I could give two shits about. Butler is a useless side character who dies and then just comes back within the next couple of moments. Holly Short is a character that just comes off as this generic character that wants to prove her father's innocence. Why in the shitting hell did they adapt two books into an hour and a half running time? Who made that decision? Why? They keep doing exposition through an interrogation scene to keep explaining how much of a genius this kid is, but this kid at no point was ever a genius. The more that this movie kept going on, the more angered I got. And by the end, I literally just went, fuck this! This movie to me is the new last airbender for this decade. Artemis Fowl has no wonder, no creativity, and no imagination. This was just a dull adaptation of a phenomenal book that I absolutely loved. I could keep going on and on, and I could continue ripping Artemis Fowl a new asshole. But for the sake of your time, I'm just gonna say, simply put, this movie can go fuck right off to hell. And in the words of my buddy Lucas, this movie can suck the devil's dick. We're finally done. We're done. Thank fuck. Alrighty guys, and that is going to wrap it up for my top 10 worst films of 2020. Please comment down, let me know below, what were your top 10 worst films of 2020? That is if you saw enough movies to make a top 10, but please let me know below. If you guys want to follow me on social media, I'm on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Twitch. I'm also on Snapchat and Stardust. So if you guys want to follow me on all those social media platforms, all the links in the user names are in the description below. I hope you guys enjoyed my top 10 worst films of 2020. If so, please hit that like button, also subscribe, and don't forget to hit that notification bell for whenever the latest video of mine goes live. If you guys want to see any of my previous two videos, please click either right there or there. And of course, until my next video, which is my top 10 best films of 2020, I'll see you guys later. See you guys tomorrow.